Hoş geldiniz. Herhatın amen kız pariyegang. Tam 10 yıl önce 2005'te İstanbul'da tarihe Ermeni konferansı adıyla geçen imparatorluğun son döneminde Osmanlı Ermenileri bilimsel sorumluluk ve demokrasi adlı konferans yapıldı. Türkiye'nin üç büyük üniversitesi, Boğaziçi, Bilgi ve Sabancı üniversiteleri, Türkiye demokrasi tarihinde önemli bir dönüm noktası sayılacak bu konferansın düzenleyici kurumları oldular. Kolay olmadı. Kurumlar dönemin rektörleri ve organizasyonda görev alanlar, Türkiye'yi sırtından hançerlemeye varacak ithamlarla karşılaştılar. Bedeller ödendi. Ama onlar bugünün yolunu açtılar. Bugün o konferanstan 10 yıl sonra, Ermeni soykırımının 100. yılında yine bu üç üniversitenin işbirliğiyle buradayız. Akademik tartışmaların özgürlük alanlarını korumaktaki kararlı duruşları ve bu konferansın organizasyonuna verdikleri her türlü destek için Hrant Dink Vakfı adına Boğaziçi, Bilgi ve Sabancı Üniversitelerine ve katkı sunan tüm dostlara tek tek içten teşekkürlerimi sunuyorum. Bu iki gün boyunca Türkiye ve dünyadan pek çok akademisyenin katılımıyla uluslaşma sürecinde uygulanan imha ve Türkleştirme politikaları ile tasfiye edilen gayrimüslim varlığın tarihinin yok olan beşeri sermaye, toplumsal ve ekonomik sonuçlarının tartışılmasını amaçlıyoruz. Mal canın yongasıdır derler. Doğrudur ama can olmadan da o mal ne işe yarar? Gelişip güzelleşebilir mi? Yaşadıklarımız bize bunu kanıtlıyor. İnsan kaynağını, zanaatkarını, yazarını, çizerini, okumuş aydınlarını kaybetmiş bir toplumda mal ne kadar gelişir ve serpilir ki? Peki bunca insanın, canın yok oluşunun ardından malın ne önemi var denmez mi? Evet denir denmesine de acaba o medeniyetin, kültürün, zenginliğin ve varlığın el değiştirmesi planın son amacı değil mi? Ben şahsen kavmimin kayıpları için her gün ağıt yaksam azdır. Bu hem Ermenilerin kaybı.
Lament the loss of the Armenians every day. This would not be enough. We have lost a lot, and actually 95% of our folk songs are like laments. Zaval Esayan, in 1909, after the Adana massacres, wrote a book called Ruins, and he gives us an account of these infernal days, and he says that we cannot possibly contemplate the atrocities committed. Actually, we reach those depths thanks to our folk songs. In our songs, we sing of Bingöl, Van, Adana. We can actually go back in time, and we can actually yearn for those days, yearn for a civilization that was destructed. For 2 years, a group of young people within the Hrant Dink Association are focusing on the remnants of the Armenian civilization, and they are creating an inventory of schools and churches in this country. And they actually turn to treasure hunters' websites to get information. Like Hrant Dink said, those who look for treasures underground are not really aware of the treasure of the Armenians above the ground, and the fact that we have seen so many sorrowful events is that people are not aware. 100 years ago, Anatolia was a thriving land, but now it is barren. Eastern part of our country, a cradle of civilizations, who hosted the Silk Road once, is now sadly barren. Exactly 100 years ago, now that we are surrounded with all these fresh sufferings, hundreds of thousands of people are being displaced, and we are seeing slaughter of innocent babies in a violent manner around us. And the clash of civilizations is rampant all around us. So why do we still insist on talking about the past? Why do we still want to talk about a civilization that was annihilated 100 years ago? As a country, previously, we were outside the discussions that were held in this regard. However, as human beings, actually, we know that these discussions were actually made, and a universal motto was devised: never forget, so that it is not experienced again. Those who are in favor of forgetting are those that are afraid of the past as well as the future, and remembrance of the past is a warranty for the future. So, in short, 100 years ago, altogether, we were living on this land, and an ancient civilization was destroyed. And today, again, ancient civilizations are on the brink of destruction. The reason why we are here today is to ask the right questions, to remember what happened in the past. Only if we do that can we actually reveal what is going on today in this, in the here and now. And if we do that, we can stop all this evil from happening, and we can altogether say never again. We are going to delve into the past today, but actually it is going to help us see today better. As I conclude my remarks, I would like to remember those that are losing their lives and that are being displaced due to the dirty war that is being waged today. We could not do this in the last century. Hopefully this century will be a century of coexistence and peace. Thank you.
Boğaziçi Üniversitesi Rektörü Sayın
I would like to invite Gülay Barbarosoğlu, President of Boğaziçi University, to the podium.
Kıymetli misafirler,
distinguished guests, members of the press, dear colleagues, I would like to start my remarks by saying that I fully agree with what Ms. Rakel Dink has just said. We need to respect diversity and differences so that we can live in a new peaceful world. So this is how I would like to start my remarks. It has been almost 9 years since Hrant Dink was assassinated. Every year our university brings together people who are prominent in the field of human rights. Through different activities, our university tries to commemorate Hrant Dink, pay tribute to him, and make sure that his thoughts live. In addition to this, our university, in cooperation with Hrant Dink Foundation, organizes scientific meetings, and this is a part of this important mission that we have. Exactly 2 years ago, within this context, in this very hall, we had the Muslimized Armenians meeting conference, and while I was opening that conference, I said that this initiative would be a good combination of our respect to Hrant Dink and our mission as the university. So this year, again, organized by Hrant Dink Foundation, we are hosting this conference called A Civilization Destroyed, Wealth of Non-Muslims in the Late Ottoman Period and the Early Republican Era, and I am extremely happy and proud to be able to address you on this occasion. This year, this initiative is more important because we have two universities from Istanbul who joined our initiative, Sabancı University and Istanbul Bilgi University. Their presidents are here, and we are very happy to see their presence here. 10 years ago, we can actually, seeing their presence, we can directly think back and remember that conference that was held 10 years ago. And now this conference is a new example of all these initiatives and efforts, and we are organizing this conference within this framework. As I conclude my remarks as the president of Boğaziçi University, I would like to salute you by respect, one by one, and I would like to welcome you and thank you.
Sabancı Üniversitesi Rektörü.
I would like to invite Nihat Berker, President of Sabancı University.
Evet, günaydın.
Good morning. I would like to start my very short remarks with great source of pride and humbleness. I do believe that we have an important burden on our shoulders today. In order to be able to carry this burden, we need courage, we need humbleness, we need empathy, we need regret, we need optimism. Because we also have to talk about optimism. I think Hrant would want it to be this way as well. And we need to work very, very hard. Today we have a difficult job, but 10 years ago, with the participation of three universities, this conference was held. And those who organized this conference 10 years ago needed to be much more courageous. Well, 10 years ago that was the case, but even 100 years ago we have seen a civilization, a nation that witnessed the destruction of their civilization. So they even had a higher or heavier burden, so we can't really complain. So what we need to do, as I have said, is to work very hard. And as academics, we shouldn't try to look for an academic interest from here, because we always discuss among ourselves and we feel good at the end. But let me make a reference to a lecture that I give. We shouldn't be thinking differently, and we should also criticize maybe ourselves to what extent we go to different places that is not a part of our own culture, to the weddings or ceremonies or worshiping places of other cultures, for instance. We should be thinking about this, because we are talking about this distinction within ourselves, maybe. We are within ourselves living together, but there is still a distinction. We can turn a blind eye on other cultures. So working together is very important. And concluding my remarks, I can say that when there is a crowd shouting and going to a place to burn that place down, if you are shouting at that moment, it's not really showing courage. But if you think about different issues, if you know your past, and if you are open-minded towards the mistakes that were made in the past, and being understanding towards this is very important. And concluding my remarks again, I would like to thank Boğaziçi University, Bilgi University and Hrant Foundation for having created this atmosphere. This will be an ongoing event, ongoing initiative. It is an inevitable effort. If we want to face ourselves as human beings, we need to work on these topics. Thank you.
İstanbul Bilgi Üniversitesi.
President of İstanbul Bilgi University, Mr. Mehmet Durman.
Sayın rektörler, değerli
distinguished presidents of universities, distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, first of all I would like to say that I am extremely happy to be able to be with you here at this very important conference, and I would like to thank the organization committee for their invitation and our host, Boğaziçi University. I would like to thank all of them. About 10 years ago, we had this conference on the Ottoman Armenians in the fall of the Ottoman Empire, and this conference was held in Dolapdere campus of Istanbul Bilgi University. In 2005, intellectuals and scientists and
academics
to come together to discuss such an important topic and to have an exchange of experience and ideas on this topic. However, after the announcement that such conference was going to take place, some sections of the society made all the efforts to prevent this conference from being held. In some of the media organs, some of the newspapers, this academic meeting was called or named as genocide conference. So later on, the conference was already convicted in the eyes of the public opinion even before it was held. So it was an important debate that was initiated. So the conference that was supposed to be held in this hall was had to be delayed because of certain reasons. And the fact that an academic conference was not held in our country was brought to the agenda of the negotiation process that was going to start between Turkey and the European Union. The speaker of Olirain, the commissioner responsible of enlargement, said that or reminded that Turkey needed to discuss all topics without having resort to violence. And after debates, the conference was able to be held on the 24th of September in Bilgi University. And in the opening of the conference, Mr. Abdullah Gül sent a message showing his good intentions. I was working at Sakarya University at that time, and I remember that there were very high, very tight security measures. And Erdal İnönü attended that meeting, and I was very sad to watch on TV that upon entering the university, there was a group of people protesting him, and I was sad to see that. But still, people made sacrifices to organize that meeting, and they gave a lesson of democracy to everyone, despite all the challenges at the fall of the empire. Ottoman Armenians conference was like an icebreaker, and it made it possible for us to be able to more comfortably discuss these issues in our country. The next day, the Radical Daily newspaper was talking about the fact that in the conference they even mentioned the name genocide, but the world is still revolving and Turkey is still intact. So maybe most emotional speech in that conference was delivered by Hrant Dink, and he concluded his remarks saying that, yes, we Armenians, we have an eye on this territory because we have our roots in this territory, but don't worry, we don't want to take away this territory, but we want to be buried here. After this meeting, about 16 months later, we were very saddened to hear the news that Hrant Dink, who said these remarks, was assassinated. And 10,000 of people participated in his ceremony when he was buried. And in 2007, Hrant Dink Foundation was established. And every year throughout the academic conferences that they organize through social projects and publications, they have an important place in our intellectual life. In the last 10 years, as the old people say, there has been a lot of water under the bridge. And we had people who were organized, who were showing organized efforts to prevent such conferences, but now you can't hear their voices that much, especially when you take a look at the commemoration events in 2015 for the 100th anniversary. We can see that the cool attitude we have shows that we have made great progress in this regard. This year's topic is called Wealth of Non-Muslims in the Late Ottoman Period and the Early Republican Era. I checked the conference program yesterday. Today we are seeing the absence of non-Muslims, and the social and economic outcomes of this absence in Turkey. This is what we're going to discuss. Yes, those who were existing here are no longer existing here. So we will talk about the gap that is created by this. And as far as I can know, we have the 1906 population census conducted in the Ottoman area. And when you take a look at the current population, we can make a comparison. And at that time, 20% of the population was composed of Armenians. And in the first census that was done in the Republican era, it was only 2.5%, and now we think it's just 0.01%. So think that in an imaginary Ottoman street, if you were to walk on that imaginary street in the Ottoman period, one out of every five person would be Armenian, but now it's just 0.01%. If we think that that street would be the same, the profile of the citizens have changed and we have lost our diversity. We have the 1915 deportation and we have the population exchange between Turkey and Greece, so the diversity of the population has changed, and it's not only about properties and assets, but our human capital and cultural diversity has also been destroyed. Maybe in the coming 2 days we will talk about sad things that make us all feel sour at heart, but as academics we have a certain responsibility towards the society that we live in, and now we believe that it's time to discuss these topics with an academic discourse respecting all different opinions. Every year on the 24th of April, our country waits the US Congress decision. Will they recognize genocide or not? We shall no longer have such a concern or hesitation. We need to analyze our history very well. The sad events that took place injured both nations, both people, and the important thing from now on is to be able to come together again. So those who make an interest of this distinction, only they want to prevent this, but we should continue our efforts, and we should, even if it's painful, we should not be sweeping things under the carpet. Muratan Mungan says, the famous poet says, if the history or past is painful, then it's not past. So I would like to thank you very much for listening to me. I wish you a very fruitful meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Without giving a break, let's now proceed with the first panel. We are going to now focus on the historical background, which will be chaired by Mr. Ayhan Aktar.
Evet, bu panelimiz.
Yes, during this panel we will be focusing on the historical background, and we have three presentations. The first presentation will be made by Associate Professor Kırmızı, born in 71 in Germany and teaches at İstanbul Şehir University History Department, and he graduated from the Social Sciences Department of Ankara University. He completed his PhD in the History Department of Boğaziçi University in 2009. He in the University of London at SOAS, he was a visiting professor, and since the inception, he has been on the board of editors of the Turkish of a Turkish historic historical publication. Mr. Kırmızı is going to present us with the findings of a project that he was a part of. We need to be mindful of the time. We are rather late. So I kindly ask each and every participant to stick to 20 minutes strictly. Thank you.
Sorry for this delay, but this was important. All the data is, this is a quantitative study, and therefore we needed this slideshow. Thanks for the organizers to allow me to share with you the findings of my latest research on non-Muslims in the Ottoman bureaucracy. And this is a TÜBİTAK project. This is a TÜBİTAK project which I am conducting with, which I'm working on since 2 years with my friends, my students, my graduate students, Onur Öner, Hümeyra Tüysüz, Gamze İlaslan, and Ahmet Emre Polat from the Başbakanlık Osmanlı Arşivi. Okay, this is a TÜBİTAK project on non-Muslims in the Ottoman bureaucracy, and we have done almost all the work on the Armenians among the non-Muslims. Our source is the Sicilli Ahval Defterleri, the personnel registers which were held only in the Hamidian times, beginning with the 1880s until the late 1910s. And we found out that 1,521 Armenians are to be found in the Sicilli Ahval Defterleri. And this makes 3% of the whole, of the total officials to be found in the personnel registers, personnel records of the Ottoman Empire. But please note that these are only mülkiye officials, adli officials, askeri officials, and so on. They are not included in this data. Most of them, almost 90%, are apostolic Armenians. There are only 10% Catholics and null or zero, yeah, 5 Protestants and 2 Muslim converts, which are found also as labeled as Armenians. The oldest born is 1815, born in 1815, and the youngest in 1893. Most are born during the Tanzimat era, as you see. And they are mostly from Istanbul. Almost 20% is from the Vilayat-ı Sitte, the 6 provinces in which the Armenians are populated mostly. And 8% in Ankara, almost 6% in Bursa. The most important result is actually that 70% of all these Armenians were first appointed during the era of Abdülhamit II. Why is this important? Because we all know that Carter Findlay, we all lean on this, still on this book, on Ottoman Civil Officialdom of Carter Findlay, which over repeats a generalization that Tanzimat egalitarianism declined under Abdülhamit, the official role of the non-Muslims was in decline by the late Hamidian period and so on. But as you see, we have to reconsider this Finley's generalizations, which was only the result of a much narrower research universe, 366 officials, only 107 of them were non-Muslims. Whereas, as you see, the employment of non-Muslims in the Ottoman bureaucracy began much earlier than the Islat Fermanı, and the Islat Fermanı doesn't look like a watershed in this table. And as the Tanzimat reforms doesn't begin with the Tanzimat Fermanı itself, we see that the non-Muslim employment in the state bureaucracy doesn't begin with the Islahat Fermanı, which officially declares that the Ottoman, that the non-Muslims can be recruited into the Ottoman bureaucracy. I separated the Hamidian era into two. This is where the massacres in 1894 begin, and as you see, suspicious of what is being happening, the Ottoman Bank and many other issues. The Armenians were involved in, some Armenian groups were involved in, and I guess there is a law, as you see, the number descended in the second term of Abdülhamit, the number of the Armenians recruited into the Ottoman bureaucracy descended a little. But still, 70%, the first appointments of 70% of all these 1,521 Armenians were in the Hamidian era, and only the 25% were in the Tanzimat era. Who are these Armenians? Let's talk a little about their social backgrounds. Most of them, 40%, are born in Istanbul, 20 in Vilayat-ı Sitte, as I told you before. Here is a more detailed list of place of birth. As you see, Ankara, Sivas, Hüdavendigar, Mamuret-i Laziz, Adana, and the list goes on. The farthest occupation, one problem of this source is they not all of the fathers occupation are available. Please note that we have only half of the the fathers occupation which are mentioned in the source. As you know, this personal records were prepared by officials who were leaning on the autobiographical. Actually, there was a answer sheet which the officials had to fill, and so they are what they give to the personnel registers. So, and half of them didn't mention the occupation of their fathers, and. Findlay, another generalization of Findlay was that most of them were sons of civil servants, but it is not, as you see. They are mostly esnaf çocuğu. 15% are esnaf. 30. Yes, I mean those. In overall, actually, 15% are esnaf çocuğu, and the others, 11% are merchants. Kids, and as you see, civil servants are only 9%. This is also a general chart which says a lot of the Hamidian bureaucracy itself. Half of the bureaucracy The highest education completed by the officials is elementary school, and only the last, you know, the 26% has a higher education than the middle and high schools of Rüştiye and İnadi. Interestingly, almost 10% visited the Sibyan Mektebi. This means with their Muslim brothers in the neighborhood, and 60% visited the non-Muslim elementary schools. What is important here are the private tutors. This says something about their economic, the economic conditions of the families. Muallimi mahsus, private tutors, if they have this, you know, economic situation to invite a professor or a teacher to their own houses to teach a language or not. And here are the places of their primary educations. Let's skip this part. Higher education is mostly in the institutions in Istanbul. As you see, Galatasaray 5%, Mülkiye 2.5% of the overall, foreign lycées, and also in, there was also something about the foreign universities. I guess this was in the next one. Yes, the universities, again in Istanbul, the Darul Funun, for example, but also almost the same number studied in European universities, and half of it like in the European technical and military schools, as you see. And looking to the cross-tabulation between the place of births and highest completed education, those from Istanbul are, of course, more like privileged in this sense, that those who studied in universities or even higher professional schools are mostly from Istanbul. Yeah, this is, we aim to see, you know, again, the father's occupations, the relation with their economic conditions, the elementary education, in the elementary education. It's again the esnaf çocuğu, the kuyumcu çocuğu, the memur çocuğu, and the tüccar çocuğu who are able to bring a private tutor, private teacher to their homes. Language skills, here at the left you see the number of languages one knows beside Armenian and Turkish. At the right side you see that those who know a language, actually the 63% of the overall, of all Armenian officials knows French. Then you see the second language is Greek, then English and Arabic, and so on. There are even people who know Latin and Bulgarian, as you see. So is it given that all Armenian officials know Armenian and Turkish? Interestingly, 30 officials were only aşina to the Armenian language. And I guess those who are not available here, they must know Armenian somehow, but you see that they are not all speaking fluently Armenian. For the Turkish, it is the same. 36 officials said they are only aşina with Armenian. The first appointments can change the spectrum of their ages. Minimum with 11 age, an Armenian official began to his first appointment in the bureaucracy. and maximum in, with 64 years, but it's approximately around 25. The age is 25 to begin with an appointment, with an earlier, with the first appointment in the bureaucracy. And the earliest one is appointed in 1843, and the latest one in our research universe began in 1914. And where they were first appointed is also important, I guess. 60% of the officials began at their birthplaces with their first appointment, with their first official duty in the Ottoman bureaucracy. For example, but mostly 475 of 903 are from Istanbul. And then in Adana, Ankara, Aydın, Baghdad, Basra, and Beirut, as you see, the numbers, they are not according to the frequency. Mostly from Ankara, Hüdavendigar, El Aziz, and Trabzon, and Aydın. These are the places where the Armenian officials first begin with their duties. And here are the first appointment in which ministries they began with their first appointments. They are mostly recruited to the Maliye Nezareti, to the Ministry of the Finances, and then secondly to the Nafia ve Tijaret, no, to the Post and Posta ve Telgraf Nezareti, to the Ministry of the Posts and Telegram. İşte, you see they are almost, both are 17%. Then comes Nafia ve Ticaret Nezareti and the Belediyes. Those who are employed in the Belediyes are mostly doctors, physicians who studied in the Mektebi Tıbbiye-i Mülkiye, which was founded in the 1867, to train physicians for the Anatolian countryside, to train them as memleket tabibi. The others are mostly engineers. Yes, thank you very much for listening. What I would like to say for the last, the impression on the non-Muslims in the Ottoman bureaucracy is mostly that the proportion descended after the Russian war because the Ottoman Empire's population became more Muslim after the Russian war. But exactly at this time, when the Ottoman Empire's population became more Muslim, the number of the non-Muslims in the Ottoman bureaucracy was growing, and this was the Hamidian time, the era of Abdülhamit II. Thank you very much for listening.
Çok teşekkürler.
Thank you very much. Now I would like to invite our second speaker, Mr. Erdem Kabadayı. Mr. Erdem Kabadayı is an academic in Bilgi University. In 2008, he had his PhD in University of Munich. He's focused on economic history and labor of the late Ottoman era. He is focusing on the history of economics and transformation of structural economy. You have 20 minutes. Thank you very much, Professor Ayhan. Hello, I will be delivering my presentation in Turkish. Some of my slides will be in English, so I hope it will help for simultaneous interpretation, and I will be addressing both languages. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers and Hranting Foundation for their determined attitude. We are seeing the fruits of this attitude, and it's a nice thing to be a part of this. Well, we were supposed to be two people presenting this. As my colleague Abdülhamit Kırmızı, I will also be sharing with you the results of a TÜBİTAK project. It was a three-year TÜBİTAK project, the Scientific and Technological Research Council of Turkey. And I will touch upon the points that is related to our conference. We have a problem in hand. We try to see the vocational structure in the 1800s and late 1800s. We have a problem of resource. There is the property count that was conducted in 1844, 1845. We just have that resource. So it can give us some data on the ethnical and structure of the country. But however, until the 1884 population census, we don't have any document, any resource available that can give us some clue. And this is the determination. This is the reason of determined policy, because the Ottoman period, they didn't do this, and we don't have important data to set the basis for our analysis. This is a period whereby we had a lot of transformation, but you will listen to the period before this and after this, because in the late early Republican era, we have important resources and data, but in the transformative process, we lack data. So I will share with you the findings, and as a comparison, I will give you the ethno-religious profile, which we can derive from the 1935-1945 general census. In terms of methodology, we worked on the occupations and how they contribute to the economic development. We believe that they contribute to economic development, but we need to codify the vocations. Without this codification, we can't know in which vocations people are actively working or in which ethno-religious background they are coming from. We can't see which ethno-religious background is involved in which certain vocations. We have been able to identify the vocations of some Ottoman citizens in 24 locations, so we have a richness in terms of the data that we have available. So we call it data mining or text mining, as we can say. We can call it the expanding digital humanities. This is the methodology that is being used, and this is called a multiple correspondence analysis. I will be sharing with you the results of our finding. I hope I will be able to give you some clues about how the methodology functions. By the way, I would like to extend my thanks to Professor Tuncer Giner. He is the advisor on our TÜBİTAK project. We received a lot of support from him on the multiple correspondence analysis. Yes, I will give you a direct example of data coding. This is going to be a numerical presentation. I hope I will be able to give you some general information. We had 88,000 people, and we coded their vocations or occupations, and we tried to answer the question, was there an ethnical or religious division of labor or vacations in the Ottoman period? Sutruski was the first academic who 100 years ago talked about this. Was there an ethnical and religious distinction or division of labor? To what extent your ethnical or religious background actually affected your profession or vocation in the Ottoman period? We have a system that is in line with the international comparisons. You see at the bottom the multiple correspondence analysis and the Cambridge working group, the International Network of the Comparative History of Occupational Structure. So one by one, we called it the vocations or occupations to the sectors, and we tried to look at the religious or ethno-religious intensifications. In our data set, we had 24 locations that were assessed. We don't have Istanbul because Istanbul was exempt of tax in 1844-45 property consensus, so we can't have the data for Istanbul, but we have a good sample from different 24 locations. What about the methodology? This multiple correspondence analysis that I talked about is important for us from a certain perspective. We can use it for categorical or ordinal data. In the Ottoman urban economies, in which cities, which ethno-religious groups were concentrating on which vocations or occupations, without an a priori formulation, we have this non-targeted pattern screening. So instead of asking what do the people in Salonika were doing, we try to ask a general question: to what extent in the Ottoman period it was effective for you, I mean your religion would affect your occupation. We can also answer the question, for instance, what is the percentage of Armenians in Kayseri in the hairdressers, for instance. So, number of total observations from 24 locations, 88,000. We have different observations from vocational data, and we also try to see to what extent your ethno-religious background affects your income level, not only your vocation or occupation, but your income as well. So we have reduced our sample to 44,000. We also omitted certain small locations because they were not representative. So in 15 locations with 44,000 people, we try to understand the effect of ethno-religious background on your occupation. By the way, from 1935, we also have the data from 10 out of these 15 locations through which I will make a comparison. I won't go into the details, but income tax or income levels were subject to a normalization system. The existing settlements or locations, their levels were calculated with local standard deviation, and with this methodology we have low, middle, high income level categories for these 15 locations. What about the results? This is the results for the multiple correspondent analysis. If we can maybe if we have time, we can go into further detailed discussions. But first thing I would like to emphasize is that in the cities of Ottoman period, ethnic background or religious background does not directly affect your occupational choice. This was tested, this argument was tested previously, but for the first time we can say it clearly based on 14 different locations. This is determinant, but not throughout the empire. Let me go into the further details. We can have 9 different groups for income levels of occupations and ethno-religious affiliation. Group 1, first group, it is the occupation that is more important rather than the ethno-religious background. Verbally, let me interpret this. By the way, I hope I don't sound so bad because sometimes I'm talking too close to the microphone. Yes, I have formulated the results. What we can identify is that especially high-level income occupations in industry and merchant, the non-Muslims are represented highly in these occupations, and in big cities they are actually in number, they are higher than the Muslims in big cities in terms of industry and commerce. It doesn't mean that Muslims are not involved in these occupations, but in terms of income level, high income earners are mainly the non-Muslims in the industry and commerce. But Muslims, on the other hand, are mainly involved in the civil servant occupations or in bureaucracy with high income level. So the high income earning Muslims are mainly seen in bureaucracy. They are tax collectors, etc. So we have two groups of high income earners. One group is more closer to the state, bureaucracy, and in the industry and commerce, we have the non-Muslims. And there is no distinction that we can make between the Armenians or Greeks, but there is a general non-Muslim concentration. What about middle and low income earners? We can't have a clear distinction between Muslims and non-Muslims. In the mid-income earners category, yes, there is a high representation of non-Muslims, but there is an equal distribution of Muslims and non-Muslims. The last thing is very determinant for us, the last finding, that is for low-income earners category, ethno-religious background does not have any relevance at all. So ethno-religious background is an important component of the social structure, but your ethno-religious background, does that really affect your social position? We tried to answer this question. I think I have five more minutes. Let's talk about the 20th century. In the 1800s and 1900s, we didn't have census data available, as I have said, and in 1935, we had the ethno-religious background that was mentioned in the census, but it's not done. And since 2000, we don't have any census that is conducted. And since the 1940s, we don't share, I mean, they don't share the results of ethno-religious background of the census. So I will give you the assessment of 1845 and 1939 with regards to ethno-religious background. There is an important thing that we need to underline, that is, in the 1840s, we use a data set based on households. So it's the household statistics. It's not a census, it's a tax census. It's not a demographic census, it's a tax census. So they just registered the taxpayers. So I hope you can see from my slide on the screen, as you can see, there is a very diverse ethno-religious composition in different cities. One thing we need to emphasize is that red color shows the Catholics. Up to 90%, the majority of the red ones, the Catholics, are Armenians. So if you want to make an assessment of the Armenian population, for instance, in Ankara and Kütahya locations, you can look at the Catholics, because most of them were Armenians. So this is household-based statistics. And let me talk about the results table of the 1884 census, demographic census results. You can't compare it on a one-on-one basis because this is the ethno-religious background of men, male of the Ottoman period census. Still, it gives us room for some comparison. So as a result, what you will see and what we can interpret from this is that between the 1840s and 1880s, in the 10 cities that we have analyzed, there is no huge difference. There is a decline in the non-Muslim population, but in some locations, Sivas, for instance, in Ankara, for instance, Erzurum, for instance, among the registered male in the city according to the 1884 census, we can see the amount of non-Muslim men. So we want to make a comparison. Although one data set is based on households and the other one is based on occupations, we can make a comparison in the following way. In the 1845 census, we looked at the cities and I have shown you the name of the cities. The brown colors show you the occupations in the agricultural sector. The second ones In red are industry and the blue ones are services. So the data set can help us to identify this occupational structure of the Ottoman cities. Well, this is not related to the topic of our conference, but I will say something on this. A surprising result was that we were able to identify quite high number of different occupations in the services sector. And going back to 1935, if we compare the different professions or occupations in the 10 cities, we can identify certain dynamics. The general assessment or the general statement is that in the 1935 occupations for men, again, the percentage of industrial occupations declined and the percentage of service occupations increased. So in 1935, we had the newly founded Turkish Republic. So it's not surprising that we have higher number of occupations in the services sector, but we need to look at the reason behind the declining industrial sector. Ms. Rakel Dink also talked about this human capital that we lost in those days. This is the sub sectors for the 1845 census. It was seen that textile was important in many cities. You can see in gray color the concentration of the textile sector. Look at Sivas, for instance. In 1935, Sivas's situation will change. You will see in the other slide. And in Ankara and Denizli, we have a higher amount of people who are working in the textile sector. Let's look at the 1935 results. What you can see is that there is a general decline in the industry. Bursa, Denizli, Tokat cities also witness a decline in the textile sector. Before I go into detailed interpretation of this, let me clarify that the aim of this project was to see how we can use the transformation of the vocations in its relation to economic development. We can use this as a proxy, the transformation in the structure of occupations, to be able to understand the economic development. So the decline in the textile sector for us shows that textile production also declined in these locations. It is difficult to apply this as a quantitative practice, but we can say that the textile fluctuation also refers to a fluctuation in the economy. There is a sharp decline in Denizli as well compared to 1845, but there is no demographic transformation in Denizli. Maybe the huge Greek population is no longer there, but the decline in Denizli cannot really be explained with the newly homogeneous structure of population. In Sivas, Tokat and other places, some of the subsectors have really been lost or gone extinct. So I will wrap up with a comparison in the services sector. We can have the same exercise. If you want, I can later on give you the figures on the graphics. But what is determining is that from the Ottoman, in terms of the transition from the Ottoman period to the Republican era, there is a general decline in the commercial sector. Some cities, some locations were able to protect their industrialized structure, and these are the ones in which we can still identify a certain number of merchants. But those cities who lost their industrial characteristics, there is also a decline in the commercial activities as well in 1935. Last but not least, let's make a comparison of the 20th century. First bullet point on the screen is not surprising. I think the surprising part of my presentation is that ethno-religious background is not really a determining factor in the distribution of occupations in the Ottoman era. However, the fall era or the transition from Ottoman period to Turkish Republic, during that period we have seen an effect, especially in the 1940s there is a decline in the employment in the textile sector, and in commerce or trade they have been able to protect the level of occupations in the 19th century, but this was result of Turkification process. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Erdem Kabadayı. Third speaker, Nilay Özok Gündoğan. She's from Mardin Artuklu University, associate professor. She has a degree from Boğaziçi University Political Sciences Department. She also studied modern history of modern Turkey, and she had her master's degree. In 2011, she had her PhD in State University in London, and she had her postdoc studies in Cornell College. And in her most recent study, she focused on the transformation of the border administration in Kurdistan in the Ottoman period. She mainly focuses on the changes in property policies and the ethnical relations in the peripheral part of the empire.
Thank you, everyone. I would like to thank the association. I participated at the Diyarbakır event as well, and I'm very happy to be here today. And it's good to be back home, because Boğaziçi is my alma mater as well. And it's been a while since I last came here.
In English, unlike my colleagues who did quantitative analysis, I will be focusing on archival and narrative sources, and I will be presenting a narrative account of Armenian wealth and dispossession in the eastern periphery of the Ottoman Empire. In 1861, three Armenians from Palu, namely Mardiros, Avedis, and Mardiros, sent a petition to the Ottoman Imperial State complaining about the local base, who were overtaxing them at an unbearable degree. Attached to this petition, there was another one signed by 48 Muslim and Armenian inhabitants of Palu, which gave a rather detailed account of how Palu Beys exploited agricultural producers through sharecropping and overtaxation. Around the same time, multiple petitions written by a certain Mardiros again flooded the imperial center, which demanded from the Ottoman Imperial State to take action against the Palu Beys, who were preventing them from purchasing land from the treasury. These lands under the question used to belong to the Palu Beys, but were confiscated by the state in the 1850s and opened up for sale. These two seemingly interrelated phenomena characterized the complaints of the Palu Armenians from the 1850s to the 1870s. On the one hand, there was the problem of the exploitation of the predominantly sharecropping population by the landholding base. On the other hand, a group of Armenian inhabitants were seeking to be able to benefit from the recent land program of the government by purchasing from the confiscated lands of the Palu base. My paper examines these two processes that emerged as a result of the transformation of the land regime in Palu within the context of the Ottoman state's policy of strengthening its infrastructural power in its eastern periphery in the mid-19th century. Starting with the 1840s, the Ottoman state set out to transform land regime and property relations in its predominantly Kurdish and Armenian eastern periphery. In accordance with the general goals of the centralization program of the 19th century, the state aimed to destroy the local elite's control over land and its surplus and create a tax-paying small peasantry. This is basically what the Ottoman state did in other parts of the empire within the Tanzimat context. The existence of the traditionally powerful and to a large degree autonomous Kurdish emirs stood as the biggest obstacle before this goal. Therefore, using a combination of military, political, and economic means, the Ottoman state sought to obliterate the control, the military and political control of the Palu emirs over land and its also surplus. It was within this context that the lands of the Palu emirs came under the gaze of the Ottoman imperial state. And in 1850, after the exile and the eventual death of the powerful Kurdish emir, Abdullah Bey, the state ventured into an ambitious land program and confiscated a large chunk of the agricultural land, which had been under the hereditary possession of the Palu emirs from the 16th to the 19th century. Actually, this part I presented in the previous conference on Diyarbakir, how the Ottoman state confiscated the lands of the Palu emirs. Now, I will talk about what happened afterwards, how people tried to gain land out of this new program. From its inception, the said land program of the Ottoman state triggered a conflict-ridden process in which local actors, both Muslim and Armenian, played influential roles. For one thing, as soon as the state confiscated the land, the inhabitants of the region tried to reach out to the imperial state in hopes of gaining land out of this new program. Petitions signed by Muslim and non-Muslim inhabitants together flooded the Ottoman center, in which they complained about dispossession, overtaxation, and forced labor, and demanded the Ottoman central state to grant them land. So there were mainly two groups among the discontented. The first was the sharecroppers, who were worried about the government's decision to open up the confiscated land to sale. Quote, the emirs and aghas, they said, unquote, have wealth and riches, while we have no power but spent labor and provided service to make these lands flourish. If the state sells these lands, the sharecroppers said, the emirs and aghas will again purchase them, and this will mean the continuation of our dependent position. They wanted to be granted free land. This is important. On the other hand, some of the claimants were hoping to purchase land out of the confiscated lands. According to the government order, which gave the land program in its final shape, the confiscated land would be divided into three. One third would be given to the emirs, the beys, while the remaining part would be divided into two halves. One half would be sold to the Muslim, and the other half would be sold to the non-Muslim inhabitants of the district for a moderate down payment. It is worth highlighting here the fact that the state used, of course, the Muslim-non-Muslim distinction to classify the claimants, and each group was granted equal house in the redistribution process. Considering the composition, population composition of Palu, it comes as a no surprise that the non-Muslim category involved mainly the Armenian population of the district. And as I will discuss, rather than being solely the victims, Armenians of Palu played a proactive role in the land redistribution process, and some of them were able to purchase land from the government. Furthermore, their actions frequently forced the local and central agents to act justly and in accordance with the spirit of the Tanzimat regime in the implementation of the new program. Around the early 1850s, Palu emirs held in total 88 villages, while the Ağalar possessed 36 villages. The total number of the villages not owned by the emir or ağas was 150. These lands belonged to the commoners or ahali, either with or without title deeds. Starting in the 1850s, the central government decided to auction the tithe of the district to tax farmers who were not from the Palu-based lineage. Regardless of how enthusiastic the state was about this program, there were a lot of problems in the region on the ground. Not long after the state set out to divide the lands, complaints from the peasants flooded the imperial center, and the Armenians of Palu acted as the front runners in this process. A certain Mardaros, who was based in Çukurçeşme, Istanbul, acted as the representative of the Palu Armenians in Palu throughout the entire process. In their petitions, Mardaros and other Armenians raised two types of problems. First set of problems concerned the Palu emir's exploitation of the sharecropping population, which manifested itself mainly through increased or double taxation. Extra taxes that the producers were forced to pay came in different names, as noksan or arz, or icare zemin, or some sort of soil rent. It seems that with the initiation of the land program, the Palu emirs deepened their exploitation of the agricultural producers to compensate for a potential loss of revenues. In 1860, Meclis-i Vala, the Ottoman Supreme Council, in Istanbul, banned the soil tax and ordered the return of the amounts confiscated by the base, yet the problem of extra and double taxation continued afterwards. The representatives of the Hoşmat village, Avadis, Bedros, and Toros, conveyed their complaints about the Palu base because they were collecting the tithe from them, even though they were already paying the tithe to the state's tax collector. This ultimately forced them to share crop for the base as they got increasingly impoverished and eventually dispossessed as a result of the deepening of exploitation. In a petition signed by the Armenian and Muslim inhabitants of Palu, they pointed out the ongoing problem of noksanars. In 1863, after the issue was discussed, again the highest council in Istanbul at the time, at Meclis-i Vala, an inspector was dispatched to the district for further investigation of the issue. He produced a detailed inventory that showed the names of the beys who collected the noksanars tax and the names of the villages that paid these amounts for the period of 1852 and 1863. Significantly, the inspector prepared separate lists for the Muslim and non-Muslim villages. It seems that it was not only non-Muslim villages, but also Muslim villages that were being overtaxed by the notables. However, the tables that the inspector prepared showed that the amount the non-Muslim villages paid was two times higher than the amount that the Muslim villages paid. So non-Muslims paid double. The difference between the amount of taxes that Muslim and Armenian villages paid might stem from a combination of both economic and political factors, such as the difference between their production levels, the difference between their taxation ratios, or the Armenian villages being more vulnerable to the oppression of the exclusively Muslim local notables. And I think it was all of these things. Maybe you are wondering why I'm using Muslim, non-Muslim terminology, knowing that almost 100% of the Palu inhabitants, non-Muslim inhabitants, were Armenians. I am actually trying to reflect the spirit of the document in this sense. State never categorized Palu inhabitants as Armenians or non-Armenians, but Muslim and non-Muslim. But as historians, we know the context here. The exploitation and the disposition of the Armenian peasantry in this way is a relatively better known aspect of the 19th century history of the region, because sadly, unfortunately, we know the end of the story and history. Armenians were dispossessed both in the urban and in the rural areas. But what is less known is the fact that the proactive role that the Palu Armenians played in the implementation of the land program and the new tax regime. In these petitions, we see that they constantly refer to the new land and tax regime in face of overtaxation and encroachment of local notables. It seems that the immediate period after the lands of the Palu base were confiscated, there was some sort of amelioration in the conditions of the Armenian inhabitants, but it was to be short-lived, and in their petitions, Armenians referred to a coalition of local notables and central appointees, namely the Çotelizade family, a local notable family in the region, the Palu emirs, the Armenian Kocabaş, and the Abdülhatif Efendi, who was the surveyor responsible for registering lands in the region. This coalition actually revived the pre-reform oppression, especially through overtaxation, and facilitated the Palu-based registration of land in their names and assisted them to build a çiftlik in these confiscated lands. In 1861, Ibrahim from Chinaz village and Hazar telegraphed a certain Bedros and a fellow townsman who was then a barber in Istanbul. They were asking for their assistance to get the government order, which would force the base to measure their harvest before taxing. In this example and many others, Armenians were using their local connection in Istanbul in tandem with the newly available communication channels in an efficient way to seek redress. Significantly, these examples illustrate that rather than being passive observers, Palu Armenians used all the means and connections possible to reach out to government and change the path of the land and tax regime in a direction that would end their oppression. For one thing, looking at the frequency and the content of the correspondence between the Palu Armenians and the imperial state, One sees that they were well aware of the details of the government's decision regarding the sale of one-third of the lands to the commoners. So they know that governments gave them this right to receive, acquire some land out of this project, and they demanded this. In August 1861, the Bishop of Palu sent out a telegram to his fellow townsmen, a bishop from Haba and a barber from Chinaz village, who were located in Istanbul. In his petition, the bishop mainly stated that they wished to purchase from the confiscated Miri land in the Palu district and pay for the tithe to the government, which was perfectly in accordance with the terms of the land program. They were even willing to pay more for the down payment than was actually demanded by the government. Obviously, even though they were entitled to purchase land out of the share granted to the non-Muslim inhabitants, they faced obstacles on the ground stemming from, of course, local power relations, for which they eventually saw the solution from the imperial center. The success of the land program in terms of the sale of the confiscated lands to the local inhabitants was limited. In many instances, the Beys divided the lands among each other and also registered the land with family members in their brother-in-law's name, mother's name, etc., which is something that happens in our contemporary age as well. In some cases, there were complaints that some of the land that belonged to the central treasury was opened up for sale without the villagers' knowledge, and that some Beys who previously controlled the area purchased them at low prices. So people, the inhabitants of a certain village, gather the information that their village is somehow sold to a certain Bey. The representatives of the Palu Armenians in Istanbul, the above-mentioned Mardiros, who actually dealt with this particular case for over 20 years, he said that if these lands were put up for auction, the producers would have to pay twice the amount that the Beys paid. Clearly, he was aware of the long-established rural hierarchy in the district, and he feared that no wonder or no matter what the central state does, they will not be able to purchase land out of this thing. But it wasn't the issue. The case again ended up in the Ottoman Supreme Council, and in a report, the Ottoman Supreme Council members asked this question: what is the reason behind giving these lands to the Beys in the face of the ongoing demands of the Ahali? In another report, the same question was reiterated. Maybe it is because the Palu Beys had long been exploiting the Ahali, just like their servants, by intimidating them, or perhaps because the Beys are having deceitful thoughts of buying these lands without paying. Of the two-thirds of the lands confiscated by the treasury, those which were opened up for purchase of the commoners were again taken hold of the Beys and outsiders. So I will summarize this code. They're saying that we want Ahali, the commoners, to purchase this land, but local Beys do not allow this to happen. Even though the success of the land program was limited in terms of the amount of land that was actually sold, there were cases in which Armenians were able to purchase land from the treasury. Previously, a certain Bedros had petitioned the imperial state about the lands of the Hoşmat village, which he said were usurped by Necip Bey. After discussing the case, the Supreme Council decided to grant the title deeds to the village inhabitants in accordance with the new land regulations. So there was some success at some level. It does not come to argue that the state was responsive to the demands of the commoners in general, or Armenians in particular. Generally speaking, however, there was widespread opinion among the Ottoman ruling circles that the Palu Beys lands needed to be seized and the local officials needed to act in accordance with the regulations. In some cases, a land purchase triggered a tug of war among multiple parties. One such case concerned the lands of the Abrank village. In 1858, a certain Sarkis purchased the lands of the village from Cemşit and Tahir Beys. At the time of their purchase, he said, they offered the villagers to buy the lands, but they did not have the economic power to purchase them. With the implementation of the new land program in the region, however, the land was taken and opened up for sale by villagers, and some of them purchased the land afterwards. Not unexpectedly, multiple and conflicting claims emerged over the ownership of the village land and down payments paid for its purchase. Another petitioner named Hachador, for instance, claimed that Sarkis encroached upon his land, which he had purchased from the emirs. The point that I'm trying to make here is that the government's land program created conflict not only between the emirs, the local notables, and the Armenians, but also created intra-Armenian conflicts because of the disagreements over land ownership. The problem stemmed partly from poor record keeping. The Ottoman state did not have solid, systematic information in Palu about basically anything, including the population figures or the land ownership. But once the state set out to transform land tenure in the region in this 19th century, it continuously faced the problem of the lack of systematic information. But the problem was also about local power relations. The land program, this new program, created confusion and turmoil, and the implementation of this new land program actually created new enemies within the locality. Pre-reform era structures and relations collided with the changing land relations as a result of the confiscation of the Palu emir's lands by the government. I will use one more minute to emphasize something. I talked about basically two processes. One, dispossession, Armenians losing their lands. This, thanks to the recent scholarship, we started to learn more about this process. But the second process is that at around the same time, we see a group of Armenians having some sort of small capital, trying to acquire or purchase land out of the government's land program. And they were actually able to do this, and they were able to buy some land. But in terms of broader historiography, what do these two things mean? First of all, as you see, I didn't focus on the later part of the century. I did not focus on the 1870s, 80s, 90s, where we see the massacres actually accelerated. I focused on a gray area. This was a context within which things have changed, things have worked differently. But parties had more or less equal saying in the land distribution process at the time. But we know what happened afterwards. But looking at these gray areas is important for two reasons. One, we remember that things were not like this all the time, and the 19th century, the entire later part of the Ottoman history, cannot be defined solely with massacres, but there were like multiple types of negotiations, multiple types of bargaining and struggle for that matter. Secondly, this kind of makes me both pessimistic and optimistic. We see that things were different, but we also see that things changed in a way that ended up in the eventual destruction of the Armenian wealth and population. Thank you.
Nilay Hanım'a teşekkürler.
We would like to thank Ms. Nilay Gündoğan. I also would like to invite the other speakers to the podium. As we have started a little late, I will take just a couple of questions. Yes, Professor Erdem. I guess the microphone is coming.
Abdülhamit, thank you for your presentation. Thank you, everyone, for the excellent presentations. When your major argument is when you counter Finley's accusation of discrimination on Abdülhamid, and the figures you give are absolute numbers, and absolute numbers don't mean anything as long as you don't have some kind of a sense of the proportion that it represents within the group during that period. So I have the impression that knowing that the number of civil servants under Abdülhamid increased tremendously, the figures you give proportionally may be very low, and there or lower than under Azizian times. And in that sense, proportionally speaking, Abdülhamit may have been discriminating. And it is clear that in the second half of his reign, he did discriminate.
For example, Findlay gives, he asserts that the non-Turk Muslims, the number of the non-Turk Muslims increased in the Ottoman bureaucracy. And the only table he was giving us, I didn't show that, there were two non-Turk Muslims in the foreign ministry and increased to 3. And he said, here there is a 50% increase in the number. You see, we have this kind of methodological problems in Finlay's book. And yes, we have to do more in means of, we have, but this is a team consisting of 5% and five persons, and it's impossible to study the whole 50,000 officials to be found in the records, sicil ahval defterleri. But yes, we have to think about this, of course. But the proportional representation was never an aim of the Ottoman government in the Islahat Fermanı. I mean, wherever you ask for it, I mean, the proportional presentation is something we look for, I guess. Now we don't have the the data for this, for that to make. I guess it's early, a little early, but it's. You are totally right. Thank you very much.
Geliyor mu ses? Nilay Hanım'a sor.
I have a question for Ms. Gündoğan. You talked about the Palu base. Who are they? Do they represent the state? Do they collect taxes? Do they own territory, land? Because there is a distinction between the AGA system and the BEY system. So can you please further elaborate on that? Thank you very much. I will answer in Turkish, as the question is in Turkish. The Palu BEYs lived in the 16th century. In the 16th century, during the Iran War, they said that they would be loyal to the Ottoman Empire. So there was minimal territorial interference in their structure, and we have different structures. We call them emirs or emanets, but since from 16th century to 19th century, which was the period I talked about, the Palu Beys held the ownership of the land, so they were land owners in a sense. And during that operation of division of land in the Ottoman period, that was the reason, actually, because Palu Beys did not want to give tax, pay tax, but with the structure of the modernizing state, they did not want to give way to any alternative power, so they wanted to confiscate the land of the Palu Beys. So the aim of this operation that was conducted was to make sure that the Kurdish Beys, or Kurdish emirs, not the Kurdish agas, would be deprived of their economic resources, which actually gave power to them. So I try to talk about this conflict. Thank you very much. Roar Zivi.
Thank you. I have two questions, one for Professor Kırmızı, one for Professor Kabadayı. For your presentation, the three presentations were very good, but your presentation was a little short on analysis, which I guess was on purpose. You gave us the data, but you didn't say why. Why is there a spike in the first period of Abdülhamit? Why suddenly this rise in, despite the loss of such a big Christian population in the empire, there is this rise? Why do you think it happens? For Professor Kabadayı, I think there's a problem here that is a perennial problem between quantitative information and the analysis. Again, you may see that there are less textile workers in Sivas, for instance, but why is this? Is it because there is a decline of the textile industry, or is it because there is a change in the production methods? And then instead of having more textile workers, you have more mechanics working machines? Or is it because there are new industries introduced, so there are still lots of textile workers, but there are people in other industries? So how do you bridge that gap between the information and the analysis.
Thank you very much. The thing is, actually, I was in bed for the last two days. I was ill, and the data was provided actually yesterday in the morning. And because it's really brand new, what you have seen here, and I didn't have much time to think about the qualitative, you know, the analysis of it. But what I My main concern is actually we are allocating in line with Yusuf Akçura's üç tarzı siyaset, we are allocating Ottomanism and egalitarianism, you know, all that comes with Ottomanism to the Tanzimat era, Islamism to the Hamidian era, and Turkism to the Young Turk era. And this is one of our fallacies in our late Ottoman historiography. What Carter Finley do is actually, although his data sometimes shows that it's very different, the opposite sometimes, he is giving credit to this a priori thinking of these eras. I mean, Ottomanism to the Tanzimat, Islamism to Abdülhamit, and Turkism to Young Turk, to the Young Turks. I guess for now this would be important. I mean, we don't have much time to talk broader about these issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question.
Professor Sebi, yes, of course, you are right. We have to contextualize the economic development in these two cross-sections in time, 1840s and 1940s, that's definitely correct. In the larger context of the project, we are also trying to assess the magnitude and timing of the industrialization, if it happened or not. So especially regarding the textile production, you are definitely right, we have to be careful about whether there was a fall in industrial production in that period. And in this aspect, of course, the industrialization thesis is an issue. The problem is there because we lack the data sources between these two observation points. And what we are trying to do, in fact, is to try to get the population registers, which made available in 2011 in the Ottoman State Archives, and use the occupational data extracted from that, and then assess the general level of industrial production. And if the textile production stays on a certain level of, if we can really see that there was no deindustrialization there, then you are right. The preliminary results that I've presented today will make more sense. The context is lacking. Very careful observation there. You are totally right. Thanks.
If there are no further questions, then we can... Professor Oanisyan, microphone, please.
I have a question to our representatives. If someone from you use Armenian sources,
thank you.
And can you answer?
No,
have you used Armenian sources? Okay, and I see the problem. Because I think that one cannot use only Ottoman or Turkish sources, especially when investigating the 19th century Ottoman history. And also one cannot write in Armenia about Ottoman Armenians using only Armenian sources. Why I am speaking about this, that I had an impression that the first presentation was just made to be an opponent on Finley's work. But if you use the Armenian language, we have a lot of works about bureaucracy, Ottoman bureaucracy, and non-Muslim, and especially Armenian bureaucracy during the Hamidian era. And about the land questions, you can use, for example, if you find somebody who translate for you, the works of Grigor Zohrab. He had excellent works, excellent research on land problems, and also about Palu.
Yes, you are right. Thank you.
I would like to thank you for that remark, but with all respect, I think this differentiation is not a very helpful one. Armenian sources or the Ottoman sources. If you mean sources in Armenian, I completely agree. But if we juxtapose the sources according to their languages and assume that the language sets the state mentality which created the source, that can be misleading. What I want to underline this is we are working with a source which is kept in Ottoman script. What that source came to being with Armenian involvement. And as you know better than I do, because I cannot read Armenian, the language of a source doesn't put it in a different box for the historian. And therefore, especially for the census material in later periods, we know that the Ottoman state was not only producing Ottoman sources. So those sources were not Ottoman. As an adjective, I think it can be misleading. So the language-wise, you are definitely right. And we, in our project, do aim to work on the sources in Armenian. And we've tried to run some pilot studies on census material. And there we've just confronted this question. If the source is not Armenian, can we say that that source is an Armenian source or not? It's a very delicate situation there. Therefore, I mean, language-wise, you're right, more the merrier. But the language doesn't really set the sources the way they create it and the way we employ them. I think, therefore, we have to be careful about that.
I also would like the few words. I absolutely agree with you. If you're doing local histories, you have to read the language and use the sources. And I don't think it's just a matter of language, because sources are, they define your methodology and the type of knowledge that you produce. But I will add to your criticism, I'm looking at Palu, but there is also a Kurdish population in Palu, and I didn't use any Kurdish sources either, unfortunately, for both ends. But I, what I can tell you about what my project can do without using Armenian sources is, one, thanks to my colleagues who did use Armenian sources, I, to a large, not a complete extent, had a grasp of the type of conflicts that these things created in Palu, thanks to their effort. But secondly, as you know, the problem is a lot of our colleagues who use Armenian sources and who created good work did not have access to Ottoman sources. And they, for one reason or the other, they couldn't use our Ottoman sources. So what my project does is just to add to that type of knowledge in terms of using how Ottoman and in what ways Ottoman sources can change the narrative. But also, I'm more interested in how states saw the issue, what answers, what responses the state gave to type of conflicts that I'm talking about. And the only place that I can do that is the Ottoman archives.
Thank you. And we have coffee break for 15 minutes.